All right, I'm very excited to introduce our next speaker, Mr. Wayne Thorburn. Wayne first joined Young Americans for Freedom in 1961 and served in many leadership positions throughout his time. He served as the executive director of Young Americans for Freedom from 1971 to 1973. Wayne has taught political science and held appointments in the Reagan and Bush administrations. He's the author of A Generation Awakes, where he describes in detail the history of Young Americans for Freedom and the birth of the modern conservative movement in the 60s and beyond. The Washington Times has said that A Generation Awakes helps to understand anew how a youth organization of like-minded conservatives with energy, imagination, ambition, and grit can take on a seemingly insurmountable political foe and triumph in the battle of ideas. Wayne's book has become a go-to resource for those seeking to learn more about Young Americans for Freedom. I myself wrote one of my final papers on the history of YAF, and Wayne's book was basically my encyclopedia throughout the entire research project. We're grateful for Wayne's continued involvement with us here at the Young Americans Foundation and his dedication to the conservative movement. Please give a warm welcome to Mr. Wayne Thorburn.
Thanks, Andres. Well, thank you all very much. It's indeed a pleasure to be here. To visit with you. I'm going to depart a little bit at the beginning here from what I planned to talk about, just to kind of put a little footnote to what Judge Smith had discussed in the last article, and to just remind you of a couple phrases in the Sharon statement, since we're here commemorating the writing of the Sharon statement and its adoption. So I thought, just to remind you, you have copies in front of you, but again, two of the clauses in the Sharon statement that are so apropos what was just discussed in the last hour, and those are that the Constitution of the United States is the best arrangement yet devised for empowering government to fulfill its proper role while restraining it from the concentration and abuse of power. And then the next phrase, that the genius of the Constitution, the division of powers, is summed up in the clause which reserves primacy to the states or to the people in those spheres not specifically delegated to the federal government. And those are two lasting phrases from the document that we're talking about this weekend that I think is most relevant to what Judge Smith just talked about for the last hour in his analysis of the importance of the Constitution. It's also important, remember he said how much, it's something that we have to keep in mind because sometimes in certain circles this becomes a dirty word, that when the Constitution was adopted, it was in many ways a compromise. And so compromise is not always bad. Compromise sometimes is an essential ingredient in achieving goals or reaching towards the ultimate goal that you want, even though you might not get all the way in one step. And that also reminds us that sometimes we shouldn't get totally locked into things, because even this phrase in the Sharon statement clearly says that the Constitution is the best arrangement, and then there are those two words, yet devised, which means, yes, this is a document that we should cherish, we should revere, we should look to as our guide, but realizing that we live in an imperfect world, we are all imperfect individuals, and so too are documents. And as Judge Smith pointed out, of course, the most evident imperfect one was the one regarding to slavery and the Three-Fifths Compromise and all the various elements that are associated with that that were in the original Constitution. Well, enough of that. I just thought I should add a little something on that to tie it back to the Sharon statement and the importance of the Constitution and how it's revered, how it's regarded as an essential element in the Sharon statement. So here we are on September the 11th in the year 2015. And September 11, as we all know, has become a very memorable date for most Americans and really for people in most of the Western world, if not the entire world. A time when we remember the tragedy that took place on our shores in the attack by Islamist militants on the World Trade Center and on the Pentagon and, of course, the plane that ended up in Pennsylvania. Just as an older generation of Americans remember when President Roosevelt called a day of infamy as the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor, the lasting significance of September the 11th, 2001 needs to be recognized by all Americans today and in the future. Now, somewhat ironically, here we are on September 11, hopefully remembering, as some of your fellow Young Americans for Freedom students across the country are remembering this day in various ways and in various ceremonies. But September 11 is also a date that has tremendous significance for America. And of course, it's because it was the day on which a very concise and yet complete statement of contemporary American conservative values and the American conservative movement was adopted. September the 11th was the final day of the original Sharon Conference of 1960, and the day in which the delegates to that meeting approved and adopted the statement that we're looking at and reviewing today. It can be viewed as the first concrete indication of a new political and philosophical movement then taking formation in America. It was, in many ways, the battle cry of the young conservative movement that would take shape in Young Americans for Freedom specifically, but also in a wide range of organizations and publications that then subsequently took root over the remainder of the 20th century. And the significance and the lasting significance of lasting importance of this one document cannot be denied. As writer Michael Johns has observed, the Sharon Statement is, quote, one of the most important documents on the American purpose and conservative vision since the Declaration of Independence itself. And Richard Viguerie, who you will be hearing from tomorrow, and one of the early founders or one of the early leaders of Young Americans for Freedom, has called it one of the most compelling statements of conservative principles and values ever written. Now, over the remainder of today and earlier today and over this weekend, you will either hear or have heard from others who have the ability to recall the formation of that document and the discussion surrounding some of its components. So that's something that I'm not really going to cover today, the history of the adoption of the Sharon Statement. But I do need to provide you with an overview of its purpose as described by the one individual most responsible for its composition, and that is the late M. Stanton Evans, who passed away, unfortunately, earlier this year. Reflecting back on that fateful weekend in Connecticut in 1960 that brought some 100 young conservatives together at the home of Bill Buckley and saw subsequently the formation of Young Americans for Freedom, Evans said, and I quote, "The objective of the statement from my point of view was to set down as concisely as possible the major themes of American conservatism, giving adequate stress to each of several components. The idea was to get a declaration which was broadly representative, but internally coherent. My belief was and still is that differing emphases within the conservative camp are aspects of a single coherent body of thought." And the draft was an attempt to show this. Now, Evans' literary creation, where he was aided by the input and influence of Carol Dawson and David Franke, resulted in a document that lives on today as a most relevant statement of those principles which identify and hold together what has been known as the conservative movement in America. Indeed, it has been credited by many with helping launch and define the American conservative movement. 5 years after its adoption by those young conservatives in Sharon, Connecticut, the statement was also adopted by the California Republican Assembly as its statement of principles. And this Sharon statement has been reprinted at various times in various collections, included in readers on the conservative movement in America, and just readers and selections on American historical documents. More than a quarter of a century after its initial adoption, a group of political and intellectual leaders, along with some YAF officials, came together at Hillsdale College to discuss the continued relevance of the Sharon Statement at the conclusion of the Reagan administration. Under the direction of Professor Mickey Craig of Hillsdale's Political Science Department and coordinated by Dr. William B. Allen of Michigan State University, 35 invited conservatives took part in a rather lengthy and weighty academic discussion for what they called Sharon 3. The end result was a reaffirmation of the relevance of the principles put forth in this document that had originally been adopted in 1960. 50 years after its adoption, another group of conservative leaders, led by former Attorney General Edwin Meese, issued an updated document labeled the Mount Vernon Statement to address 20th century concerns. And what did they do? They modeled it after the Sharon Statement. And still others have attempted to update what was written in 1960. But the relevance of the original document and its role in unifying the various and disparate elements into a single conservative movement remains today. As Christopher Bedford, who we are pleased to have with us today and is a vice chairman of Young Americans for Freedom, wrote in YAF's New Guard some, I guess, 4 or 5 years ago, if I recall, the Sharon Statement reminds us that, and I quote, "We are not simply a base creature made up of material needs, but we are a spiritual creature as well. Man's greatest feature is his spirit. It sets him apart from common animals, and it is the mortal aspect of man's spirit that makes every person a unique individual, setting him apart from his peers." And Bedford then went on to discuss the relevance of the Sharon Statement in the context of its application to the political and social environment of today, seeing it as a continuing guidepost and reference for today's conservatives. And among the many prominent public figures associated with the conservative movement and the principles outlined in the Sharon Statement, none is more important than the 40th President of the United States, Ronald Reagan. Reagan's association, as you may well know, with Young Americans for Freedom and the Sharon Statement goes back to a time when he was known, if he was known at all, as a Hollywood actor. Having joined the National Advisory Board of this new organization in early 1962, and then later, in that same year, he agreed to sign a much-needed fundraising letter to help build the organization. Reagan's association with YAF is also reflective not only of his early commitment, but also with his dedication to responsible conservatism reflected in the principles of the Sharon Statement. And this was also made evident in 1962, that same year that he joined the advisory board, well before his speech for Barry Goldwater, and well before his own subsequent appearance as a political candidate. It was a time, way back in history, when the leader of the John Birch Society was making rather exorbitant claims against some prominent Americans, including former President Dwight Eisenhower. And this led William F. Buckley Jr. to disassociate conservatism as reflected in his magazine National Review from Robert Welch and declaring that he was, quote, damaging the cause of anti-communism by turning away potential supporters with his broad-brushed labeling of individuals as communists. After his editorial denouncing Welch appeared in National Review, Buckley received a multitude of letters, both supportive and critical of his action. One letter in particular took on much more significance over time. This letter told Buckley that, quote, "You have once again given a voice to the conscience of conservatism. As always, the voice is clear and repudiates the easy downhill path of expediency." And then in a paren, it says, "That path is so crowded with liberals these days. Now we shall eagerly await a liberal definition of left and far left." The letter, as you may have guessed, was signed Ronald Reagan, Pacific Palisades, California, and was early proof that indeed Reagan stood for a responsible conservatism that did not fall into the trap of believing that there were no enemies to the right. Reagan and Buckley soon developed a lifelong relationship that is recorded in Buckley's book, The Reagan I Knew, that was published posthumously in 2008. Reagan's relationship with the organization founded at Buckley's home grew and intensified from the initial interactions in 1962 on through the years of his presidency and beyond. When Yaff went to San Francisco to support Barry Goldwater's crusade for the Republican presidential nomination in 1964, Ronald Reagan was integrally involved in Yaff's public efforts. On Tuesday of that Republican National Convention, Yaff sponsored a major rally for Goldwater, and it was Reagan who served as master of ceremonies. Then the following night, Reagan spoke at another Yaff rally outside the convention hall. Reagan spoke from a flatbed truck and told the Yaff members rallying for Goldwater, quote, "You were at this long before many, and God bless you for it." Without a doubt, one of the most significant speeches in the life of Ronald Reagan was the one he gave in support of Barry Goldwater that fall. It was a speech that almost did not occur, that nearly was cut from the television broadcast schedule. And the fascinating story about that speech and how it came about being broadcast is told in Ron Robinson and Nicole Hopland's book, Funding Fathers, for those who may be interested in the backstory on its broadcast. Reagan's speech was titled, A Time for Choosing. Not only is it an accurate description of the fundamental beliefs and values of Reagan, but also an accurate reflection in so many areas of the principles enunciated in the Sharon Statement. So therefore, I think it's valuable today to looking at the relevance of the Sharon Statement to Ronald Reagan, it's valuable to compare and put side by side, just for a moment, some of the phrases in A Time for Choosing with the relevant sections of the Sharon Statement. Now, if you've had a chance to look it over and are familiar with it, you recognize that at its beginning point, the Sharon Statement affirms that each individual has certain transcendent values, values that are beyond and last forever and beyond any human control, including free will, which comes from man's creator. And to quote the Sharon Statement, that foremost among the transcendent values is the individual's use of his God-given free will, whence derives his right to be free from the restrictions of arbitrary force. Now, it's this fundamental belief put forth clearly in the Sharon Statement that is an essential element of American conservatism. The individual matters. And his rights come from God and not from any earthly rulers. As such, they are inalienable and cannot be taken away. The statement and the Reagan speech were written at a time when the federal government was expanding well beyond anything experienced before, even well beyond the incursions of the made by the New Deal. Programs to extend federal control were being enacted under the guise of worthwhile functions of government, such as providing national defense. The first major federal education programs were enacted under the title the National Defense Education Act, created in the 1950s, as was the National Highway Act, which was sold to Congress and justified on the grounds of moving troops and national defense. Reagan reiterates this belief in the God-given free will of man in his speech, A Time for Choosing, and his concern that too often these rights are now being viewed as having come from government. And I quote from his speech, "Our mutual unalienable rights are now considered to be a dispensation of the government, and freedom has never been so fragile, so close to slipping away from our grasp as it is at this moment." The Sharon statement then goes on to maintain, quote, "that liberty is indivisible and that political freedom cannot long exist without economic freedom." Well, Reagan clearly reflects this view when telling his audience that, and I quote from that speech, "A government can't control the economy without controlling people. And they know when a government sets out to do that, it must use force and coercion to achieve its purpose." And as author Michael Johns noted, this speech was hugely and transparently influenced by the Sharon statement's position on the importance of extending and defending economic liberty. Well, then the Sharon statement goes on and reminds us, "The purposes of government are to protect these freedoms through the preservation of internal order, the provision of national defense, and the administration of justice. That when government ventures beyond these rightful functions, it accumulates power, which tends to diminish order and liberty." So here's the ultimate question that Reagan poses to his listeners in A Time for Choosing, calling upon voters to decide whether they believe with him and the Sharon statement that there are limits on what government should do and that individuals can govern themselves. As Reagan said in that broadcast, quote, "This is the issue of this election, whether we believe in our capacity of self-government or whether we abandon the American Revolution and confess that a little intellectual elite in a far distant capital can plan our lives for us better than we can plan them for ourselves." It's been more than 25 years since the fall of the Berlin Wall, and nearly that long since the Soviet Union crumbled and communism became a near irrelevancy. At the time of the Sharon statement, however, and the time when Reagan gave his speech supporting Barry Goldwater, we lived in a quite different environment, with the ever-present challenge of the Soviet Union, a powerful, aggressive, and ideologically driven force seeking world domination. So in this context, the Sharon statement tells us, quote, "that the forces of international communism are at present the greatest single threat to these liberties, that the United States should stress victory over rather than coexistence with this menace." Remember again with this phrase that comes in this section again, "forces of international communism are," next two words, "at present," taking into consideration that we may subsequently have other challenges and threats to our liberties, which we certainly could identify at the present time. Reagan reflected this perspective on reality when he told his listeners in that speech, quote, "We're at war with the most dangerous enemy that has ever faced mankind in his long climb from the swamp to the stars." Clearly, Reagan wanted the American people to be cognizant of the enemy we were facing. And then he goes on later in the speech to call for a firm stand in opposition to the Soviet Union and its attempts at world domination. But finally, the Sharon Statement maintains, quote, that we will be free only so long as the national sovereignty of the United States is secure, that history shows that periods of freedom are rare and can exist only when free citizens concertedly defend their rights against all enemies. Now, for Reagan, this is indeed the overriding challenge confronting the American people. So he reminds them that, quote, "You and I have a rendezvous with destiny. We'll preserve for our children this, the last best hope of man on earth, or we'll sentence them to take the last step into 1,000 years of darkness." Ronald Reagan was not in this speech merely advocating the election of his candidate for president. More importantly, he was spelling out his understanding of American history, his perception of the problem confronting the American people, and his vision for overcoming the threats and challenges to individual liberty. Clearly, whether by study or by osmosis, Ronald Reagan was also reflecting the values put forth only a few years earlier in the Sharon Statement. These values would be reflected many times more over the coming years, including in his 1967 inaugural address as governor of California. I think you can hear the echoes of the Sharon Statement when Reagan proclaimed, "The time has come to re-implement the original dream that resulted in the forming of this nation, that you and I have the capacity for self-government, the dignity and ability and God-given freedom to make our own decisions, plan our lives, and control our destiny." Furthermore, Reagan's speech to the 1971 National Conference of Young Americans for Freedom, and again his remarks on the 20th anniversary of the founding of YAF, a time when he was on the verge of becoming President of the United States. Both of these documents reflect the beliefs and values represented in the statement crafted by young conservatives back in Sharon, Connecticut in 1960. These values put forth in the Sharon Statement are also seen in those influential 5-minute radio addresses that Ronald Reagan gave with some intervals from 1975 to 1979. Programs that were initially sponsored by Young America's Foundation and were heard in thousands of communities across the nation. Reagan's dedication to conservative principle, his dedication to research and seeking out information, his skill and creativity as a writer, all these are apparent in the texts of these radio broadcasts. And fortunately, those texts can be found in a valuable collection titled Reagan in His Own Hand, which reproduces many of the handwritten texts that became the basis of the 5-minute commentaries that he gave over the radio. One writer called them, quote, "awe-inspiring in their breath. These essays laid out the philosophical framework for Reagan's presidency." Reagan's various speeches during the 8 years of his presidency expressed views that remained faithful to these same principles put forth back in 1960 by the authors and adopters of the document known as the Sharon Statement. It's no surprising, then, that Ronald Reagan had a lasting relationship with Young Americans for Freedom as the organization that reflected those views he shared. Over the past 55 years, the Sharon Statement has been an effective representation of American conservative principles. As the foremost political representative of those values, Ronald Reagan reflects the Sharon statement in his many remarks as a public personality, as governor, and then subsequently as president. Now, while Reagan exemplified those principles, it has been more than a quarter century since he sat in the Oval Office, presiding over an administration that sought to advance the very principles espoused in the Sharon statement. Time moves on, and we live in a different century with its own unique challenges to liberty. We must recognize there was only one Ronald Reagan, and efforts to recreate him in the form of another political leader are bound to fail. However, principles which he promoted are as relevant today as in the last century. To that end, the Sharon Statement remains today a beacon and a standard, an inclusive statement of fundamental principles by which the contemporary American conservative movement can be defined. We can continue to look to it as a guidepost for confronting our current situation. And it is in that context that remembering, recalling, and recognizing the Sharon Statement on this, the 55th anniversary of its adoption, is most appropriate. And I commend each of you for your attention and dedication to that analysis. Thank you all very much.
We do have some time for questions.
I'm separating them from dinner, so I think this is not cocktail hour, but it's dinner, so that may be part of the situation. Thank you all very much. I hope you have a great conference. And oh, my goodness. Oh, okay. All right. Fear and trembling as the president.
No. My recollection in the years that I was first involved in Young Americans for Freedom, students had to agree with the Sharon Statement to join.
Right.
So as difficult as it is to get people to consider our ideas, the idea that you had to agree with our ideas even before you could be a member was quite a challenge. And the biggest challenge at the time was not the clauses about the free market or even God-given free will. But the biggest stumbling block that I saw at the time was that we must seek victory over rather than coexistence with this menace. That is, the idea was much about at the time that Reagan's ideas along those lines, Sharon Statement's idea along those lines, Barry Goldwater's book, Why Not Victory? All this was belligerence, would lead to world war, would bring about the end of the world. In fact, in Reagan's ranch, you have a leftist poster goofing on Reagan and Margaret Thatcher, Gone with the Wind, which suggests they would blow up the world, and she would follow him to the end of it. He would organize it, and she would follow him to the end of it. And yet, we now know, because that part of the Sharon Statement was the most triumphant. So maybe the most difficult part became, in fact, the part that was implemented. Anything you want to add about those years? Because you were obviously very much involved about whether that was the clause that gave people the hardest time, and any reflections or insights into how difficult that seemed at the time as compared to any of the clauses that may seem difficult today.
Well, I think there was some difficulty because we have to remember that, particularly in here goes a little bit off the topic perspective, but I think it's important. If you want to know about American history, in my book there were two decades of the 1960s. Okay, the first decade of the 1960s starts around prior to the formation of Young Americans for Freedom in September of 1960, and probably goes up to about after the election of Johnson, the Goldwater, that period of time. During that period of time, the movement on most college campuses that had a political movement on most college campuses that appealed to young people was conservatism. That was really, there's a quote from one guy who says, You know, I wear my Goldwater button on campus and I feel the thrill of treason, because you were rebelling against what was perceived as the liberal establishment by doing something to clearly identify with, whether it be a YAF button or a Goldwater button. Okay? The early 60s, the real movement was conservatism, Buckley, Goldwater, etc. It's only as you get into the really the second half, and maybe part of it is because of the expansion of the war in Vietnam, the then subsequent growth of groups like the Students for a Democratic Society, that what so many historians now talking about the 60s are really talking about the second half of the 60s. They're talking about the time of student riots, the riots in major cities by African-American radicals, and others, okay? So it's only in that rather later part that you get it. In the early part, I don't think that victory over communism was too much of a problem. It probably was more when, because you're younger than I am and you got involved a little bit later than I did, for sure. However, I think it does bring back to Reagan. What was the one commitment that among above and beyond all others that Reagan had in his presidency? It was to save us from nuclear war, to prohibit the possibility of any nuclear war, but also to defeat communism and to survive the challenge from communism, something that time-wise came under his successor by a year with the fall in 89 of the wall. So yeah, there was some, but not in the early days. I think that came later, particularly with Vietnam. And I think that's probably where it came in. Anyway, yes, sir.
Mark Erste, Franciscan University of Steubenville. So my question is, now that communism has been defeated, what are the greatest challenges that the conservative movement and liberty face?
Well, there's many challenges to liberty and to the conservative movement, probably in the context of what was talking about there to the world. It would be the radical Islamist challenge in its various and sundry elements. That really is the challenge to Western civilization and individual liberty. Yeah, without a doubt, that would be. Anyone else?
You were mentioning right now that communism was defeated in the 20th century, well, 1989, with the Berlin Wall's fall. But I actually differ with that. Actually, I was writing right now a blog, and I actually noticed an interesting thing in Wikipedia. I looked for every single fascist dictator in Wikipedia, and then I looked for every single communist dictator in Wikipedia. The first paragraphs for the fascist dictator was, for example, he was a murderer, dictator, the leader of the totalitarian regime, yada yada. And then you look for the communist dictator, and the words were he was a, I don't know, a diplomat, a revolutionary.
Humanitarian.
Yes, like a romantic brush.
Right.
Portraying these murders, right? So my conclusion was that nowadays, if you look at, for example, South America, Spain, Greece, etc., you cannot say communism is defeated. It's simply hiding within socialism's opium, you could say. So, for example, a lot of people nowadays don't acknowledge the fact that in 1990, after the Berlin Wall fell, Fidel Castro created, in that time, the leader of Brazil, remember his name, something called Foro Sao Paulo, which is, like, you could say, a UN of communist leaders around the world. So that exists nowadays, and they are creating all the leftist strategy around South America, and they're involved in Spain right now, and they're involved in Greece. So I don't think we can say that communism perished in the 20th century. I think actually we're experiencing its dawn. So why, in your, if communism was defeated in the 20th century, why do you think this, let's say, things are happening in South America, Spain, okay, and Greece?
Right. Okay. All right. Well, then let me clarify. When I said communism, I mean an international communism force which has military strength, weapons that were a direct challenge to the West and to the United States. It was a coordinated effort that was undertaken by the Soviet Union in sponsorship of other countries. Whereas I think what you have now, yes, there is communists and there are communist movements, much as there are other ideological groups across the world, but it's not coordinated. It doesn't have the centralized military strength that was present in the 20th century under.
Well, it is growing in other ways.
It could very well be.
Culturally, well be. Which in my vision of things is even more dangerous.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Yeah, I guess I was stressing more the military than anything else.
Yeah, okay. Thank you.
Yep. Thank you all. Did you have a question or?
No.
Nope.
You did. Sorry.
One more.
Hi, I'm Joe DiGioni from Virginia Tech, and it kind of spawned off of his question.
Yes.
But I was wondering how you feel about China right now, because China is a red state.
Right.
And right now, they are democratizing in a certain fashion. What do you think, is that going to be like a challenge for America, or is that something that we're going to be able to?
It's definitely a challenge. I don't think it's an ideological challenge. It's an economic challenge. It's a challenge in terms of the influence in countries in Asia. It's certainly a challenge on the seas. It's making claims on territory that has been regarded as either Japanese or South Korean, Indonesian territory. So yes, it's a challenge, but it's of a different nature. I think, yes, they may call themselves, some people criticize some individuals in the Republican Party by calling them rhinos, which translates to Republicans in name only. In many ways, the Chinese are sinos. They're communists in name only. The ideology is not as it was under Mao. It's not as it was under Stalin or under Lenin as the overriding objective. It's almost more like a power emphasis of the Chinese and a nationalistic power drive that is a threat and is a threat to other areas of the world. But it's not so much based upon the ideology of Marxism-Leninism.
Well, the reason why I ask is one of our classes at Virginia Tech, my roommate is taking the class, and the professor said that had been increased diplomatic activity with a lot of the Southeast Asian,
yeah,
and like Malaysian,
right,
and Australia.
Right.
And it seems that we are trying to build a sense of a base,
right,
of support there, especially since the United States has now a base in Australia, which hasn't happened before,
right,
in the longest time, actually ever, I think, if I remember correctly. So I just wanted to kind of see what your opinion on it was.
Yeah, no, I think there's a political and economic challenge, but less of an ideological challenge as it was before. Thank you all very much.
How about another round of applause for our speaker, Wayne Thorburn?